الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وبه نستعين وصلى الله على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد ربي أنتقنا بالهدى وألهمنا بالتقوى أما بعد فقد قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الحكيم وهو أصدق القائلين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولله الأسماء الحسنى فادعوه بها آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلي على محمد وآل أما بعد السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Nice to see so many strong faces as we wind down to this first fast of ours. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshallah accept the efforts that we have put forward today and that He gives us strength to carry on inshallah for the rest of the month. I know nobody wants to hear something deep and something mind-boggling, so I'll try to keep it as light as possible. I gave the introductory speech yesterday as far as what the month of Ramadan holds for us and how we can maximize the time in the month of Ramadan. We did that yesterday, alhamdulillah, on the first night of the holy month. From here on out, inshallah, since this is Shahrullah, since this is the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will carry on inshallah with the same topic that I did last year, where every night we will discuss one or two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah says in the Holy Quran, وَلِلَّهِ الْأَسْمَاءُ الْحُسْنَى To Allah belongs the best of names, so call Him by them. Hence it is important for us to know what these names mean. We see 99 names sometimes written around the wall, or we have our children memorize the 99 names, but do we really know the power behind each name? And if we do get an understanding of what that name means, there is a possibility that I might call Him when I really need Him by the right name, and it will make the world of a difference to understand that. So we'll carry on from where we did last year, inshallah. And as I said, this is Shahrullah. It is important that we understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better. Last year, we went alphabetically from Alif and we got to Jim. And today we carry on from the letter Jim and move on, inshallah. If time permits, what I also want to do is, the last couple of minutes, I want to discuss the ahkam or the rules of fasting. Yeah. So, not only do I want to cover the names of God, but I want to at least give a few rulings based on the rulings of Sayyid Sistani, Hafidhahullah, as far as what is wajib for us and what is haram for us in this month of Ramadan. I hope that you already know these rulings, so it will be a repeat for you, because we should know these rulings before we commence the month of fasting. But I do want to go over them just as a reminder, because God says, remind, there is benefit in reminding, inshallah. So the name that we start with today is Al-Jawad. Al-Jawad. Al-Jawad literally means one who is open-handed. Yeah, that means their hand is always open and they're always ready to give whatever it is that is asked for. And of course, this is one of the most beautiful names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in that He gives without, whether you know Him or you don't know Him, He will still give you. This is the beauty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have in this world today. 1.6, let's say 2 billion Muslims, the rest of the population does not worship God the way He wants them to be worshipped. Yeah? They do not follow God the way He wants to be followed, yet He provides sustenance for them, yet He provides life to them. This is an example of the open-handedness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Put ourselves in that situation, if we were generous with somebody, but yet they did not behave properly, or they were rude to us, or they did something bad to us, would we continue to be generous with that person? Likely not. Yeah, we would end our generosity because that person was not reciprocating it back to me, for example, or was not appreciative of my generosity. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is completely opposite, in that He gives whether you believe in Him or not, He will continue to provide. Open-handedness is one of the most endearing qualities a human being can have. Yeah, it is a quality which people automatically fall in love with compared to one who is stingy. And this is why there's a very beautiful hadith from Imam Ali alayhi salam where he says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Judur rajulu yuhabbibuhu ila adadihi wa bukhluhu yubaghidhuhu ila awladihi. He says that man's open-handedness endears him even to his enemies. Yeah? While stinginess makes him hated even by his own children. Yeah? You all follow me? This is how important open-handedness is that even if your enemy will recognize the value of this quality, and they will say no, that he is at least an open-handed person. This is why, for example, Muawiyah la'natullahi alayhi, when he would have people come to his gathering and he would ask them to curse Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, and if they ever said something which was not true, for example, if they ever said that he was stingy, that he was not a good warrior, even Muawiyah, the one who hated Ali, would stop him and say, don't lie about Ali. The fact is, we know the truth about Ali ibn Abi Talib. And this is what is said to us, that this kind of characteristic, open-handedness, endears us to even those who may not like us, for example. When we look for examples of the open-handedness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has provided for us existence. Even though none of us here can say today that I deserve to be in existence. Who can say that honestly, that I must be created? None of us can say that. The fact that we have been given existence is a sign of the open-handedness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only that, He provides for us rizq, He provides for us sustenance, whether it is wealth, health, children, all of these are signs or alamat of the open-handedness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only is He open-handed with all of His creation, when we look at specific brackets of them, for example, if we look at those who disbelieve or those who do bad, even with them, God is open-handed in that He has always left the door of forgiveness and repentance open for them to come back to God. This is open-handedness. This is generosity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as far as the believers, He is open-handed with us specifically in that He constantly gives us opportunities to get closer to Him. Like Shahru Ramadhan. Yeah, this is an invitation which God has given to everybody, yet only the believers accept this invitation in hopes of getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of these are examples of the open-handedness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is very important to remember is that the open-handedness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is different than a human being who is open-handed. I may be generous, but with my generosity, there is a limit to it. I can only give as much as I have. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's generosity knows no limits. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, in Surah number 15, verse 21, وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا عِنْدَنَا خَزَائِنُهُ. He says, there is not a thing that is present in this world, except that its source is with us. Its khazana is with us. Yeah, that means if we see, for example, the love of Allah, the masdar or the source of love is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we see the generosity of Allah or the forgiveness of Allah or any quality of Allah, it can never come to an end because the source of that generosity or that source of that quality belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? Very different than I or other human beings, where I may be patient, but there will come a time when my patience will run its course. But with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will never happen because He is patience. Yeah? If you want to look at the definition of patience, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this same example can be taken with any of the other characteristics or with anything else. And the perfect example is that of rain. God, you know, gives example of rain, that water that we see in this world is nothing but in a limited form, in that it comes from the ultimate source, which is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the form of clouds, for example. Yeah. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Jawad. Now how do we adopt this quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This is a very important point. It is good to know, and it is important to know God and why He is called Jawad, for example. But it is equally important to know how I can adopt this quality into my life so that I can have this quality of God as well. This is the important part about the Asma'ullah, is that we are being told, for example, in a hadith, تَخَلَّقُوا بِأَخْلَاقِ اللَّهِ. Yeah? Adopt yourself with the akhlaq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how do we know what the akhlaq of God is? Is through these most beautiful names of His. So if God is open-handed, it means that I must be open-handed in the course of my life. So how do I become open-handed? First is that I must become open-handed and generous with everything I have for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yeah? The one that has given me everything, I must reciprocate it back to Him and show that I am not stingy with what He has given me. Yeah? This is very important. If God has given me wealth, I cannot be stingy with that wealth. I must be open-handed with it. Hence, I must pay khums, I must pay zakat, I must give sadaqat, I must do all of these things in giving it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because it is He who has given it to me. Yeah? Likewise, if He has given me health, I must use that health in a way which will benefit other people for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that means that when it comes to sleep, for example, we all have been given this gift where we like to sleep, alhamdulillah, right? But when we want to be open-handed, it means that I cut my sleep in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why Salatul Layl is so important. And I humbly advise myself before I advise you, because I know how difficult it is to recite Salatul Layl. Especially when you are in that young stage, you know. Oftentimes a lot of people tell me, you know, a lot of older people, no offense, yeah, they tell me that I recite Salatul Layl all the time, but you know, your sleep is cut off by 3:30 in the morning anyways, or 4 o'clock in the morning. No offense, yeah, I say this with all love. But for the young ones here, who can sleep, mashallah, from night to day, yeah, and day to night, if they were, for example, to cut their sleep for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I think that would hold a lot more weight in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes. That is why the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his family, has said numerous times, there is nothing more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than a youth who does istighfar, or a youth who busies himself in worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the prime time for us, yeah? For the youth especially, I think I'm out of that bracket now, but for the youth, this is the prime time where God wants to see that when you are young and had the energy to do whatever it is that you wanted to do, did you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or did you decide to go somewhere else? So this is one of those things that we have to do to become Jawad like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, wa ali Muhammad, he says, Ajwadun nasi man jada bi nafsihi wa malihi fi sabilillah. The most generous of human beings is the one who is generous with his own soul and his own wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means whatever we have, we give it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second way we can be Jawad as well is by becoming open-handed and generous with other people. Yani, the first one is different than the second one. The first one is that I am open-handed for God. Yeah? That means I give my time to God, I give my wealth for God. The second one is that I am open-handed to people. That means if somebody comes to me with a request and I have the ability to fulfill that request, I must never say no. I don't know if you've ever met an open-handed person, a truly open-handed person. They're a very rare breed, but they are very beautiful people. There is nothing stingy about them. They would give you the shirt from their back. You know that expression that they would give you the shirt that they were wearing? Literally, an open-handed person will give you everything that they have. And alhamdulillah, in my course of my studies, I had met, out of all of the people, all of my teachers, two had these qualities of generosity, of not just generosity, just open-handed, where whatever you asked from them, they would give you, whether it is time, whether it is books, whatever it is that you can think of. These people had this quality of open-handedness, and it cannot come. Yeah, this quality does not come just by me trying to be open-handed. God wants to see me in action in being open-handed. Once He sees that I am sincere in my open-handedness, He will then make me into a person who is open-handed. Yeah, I cannot do it myself. This is the reality of any beautiful quality which God wants from us. If God wants us to be a muttaqi, if God wants us to be a mutawakkil, if God wants us to be a sabur, shakur, all of these things will not come just because I do it. God will test me with it, and when He sees me sincere in it, He will make me into this quality. Imam, I will end with a hadith here. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam says, Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, لا يكون الجواد جوادا إلا بثلاثتين. That a generous person or a jawad will not be a jawad unless that person has three qualities. An open-handed person cannot be called open-handed until they have three specific qualities. The first, يَكُونُ سَخِيًا بِمَالِهِ عَلَى حَالِ الْيُسْرِ وَالْعُسْرِ. That he is generous with his wealth in times of ease and in times of difficulties. That you will not be able to tell a difference whether this person is going through difficulty right now or hardship, because they are still generous. Yeah. Now I know that maybe then we ask the question, well, the level of generosity may change. True. The level of generosity may change, but they will still find a way or try to make sure that no person goes away from his house without his hajat being fulfilled. Yeah? This is a person really worries about that, an open-handed person. And I think the second quality that is mentioned by the Imam alayhi salam may answer the first question as well. And the second quality, he says, وَأَنْ يَبْذَلَهُ لِلْمُسْتَحِقِ. That he bestows his wealth to those who are deserving of that wealth. This is very interesting. Yeah. It is not time. I don't have time for this. But in my study of this subject, because I find this subject of generosity quite interesting, there are times when we have stories that a man would come to our Imam alayhi salam, anyone it can be, and without that person even asking them for their hajat, the Imam alayhi salam would just grab some money and give it to them. Yeah? Without even them asking their hajat. And in certain situations, especially for example with our second Imam, Imam al-Hasan alayhi salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Once a man came to him and he said, you know that I have a need, and let me explain to you what my need is. And before he even explained, the Imam took out 20,000 dirhams, 20,000 silver pieces, and gave it to him. And the man was shocked and he says, don't you want to know what my need is? Yeah? How can you just give me this type of money? And the Imam alayhi salam said that, we the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam do not like to humiliate somebody by having them tell us their most deep and down and the worrisome matters. That means we don't even want to know. The fact that you had the need to come and ask me for it is enough for me to know that you are truly needy for it. But at other times, we find, for example, that people would come to the imams and they would ask them questions. They wouldn't ask them, maybe this is the answer, subhanAllah, it just came to me. They would not ask them about their need. They would ask them to gauge the level of their faith. Yeah? At what level of understanding did they understand Tawheed? What understanding of adalat did they understand? And you find sometimes Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam, for example, would ask questions that maybe you and I would not know the answers to. But when somebody came, and I think maybe that's what the Imam means, subhanAllah, that he says you give it to those who are deserving. Yani people who have the ability to understand God, people who are believers, you give these people before you give anybody else who comes and asks you. Maybe this is an answer. Maybe you can find something else as well. And he says, وَيَّرَى, the third quality is, وَيَّرَى أَنَّ الَّذِينَ أَخَذَهُ مِن شُكْرِ الَّذِي أَسْدَى إِلَيْهِ أَكْثَرُ مِمَّا أَعْطَى. And he finds the gratitude of the one he gave it to greater than what he gave him. Yeah, that means that thank you or that appreciation that you felt by me being open-handed is worth more to me than that money that I gave you. And this is the third quality of an open-handed person. Inshallah, tomorrow we will continue with more names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if we are going to adopt this name, this is the month in which we adopt this name of Jud and Jawad. Yeah, we try to be open-handed in this month to the best of our abilities, even if it is to feed one person iftar, that in itself will guarantee us Jannah inshallah. So we try to practice that in this month. I want to take 2 minutes and go over some ahkam of fasting. When we look at the book of our marajah, for example, whoever your marja is, they first define what is fasting. And they say fasting means that a person must, in obedience to the commands of Allah, from the time of adhan of fajr to the time of maghrib, avoid 9 things. Yeah. So this is what a fast is. A fast is that I have in my mind that I am purposely or consciously, yeah, that's the right word, I am consciously avoiding 9 things which God has forbidden from me during this month. We will discuss inshallah tomorrow what these 9 things are. But today we want to start with the most important condition of fasting, and that is our intention, our niyyah. If we do not have niyyah, our fasts do not count. Yeah, this is very important that inshallah today or last night when we went to sleep, we took out the niyyah of fasting. And if we didn't, we'll look at some of these rules where, for example, Ayatullah Sistani says that if you do not take out an intention, you have a qadha fast on your hands, because the fast of today was not accepted without intention. Yeah? But the intention does not necessarily need to be verbalized, right? If I know that tomorrow I'm not going to eat or drink or do these 9 things for the sake of God, that is intention in itself, right? But it is better, Ayatullah Sistani says, that you take out intention on the first night of the month of Ramadan, that you are going to fast for the entire month. Hence, if you ever forget, you are covered, that you have already made this intention. And in order to ensure that you have been fasting or that you have been avoiding these 9 muharramat throughout the day, it is better that you begin abstaining from these 9 things before the adhan of fajr and until after the adhan of maghrib has finished. Yeah, meaning this is why we have imsak before fajr, right? Sometimes you have 5 minutes, others have said 10 minutes, others have said 15 minutes, depending on the calendar. I think here they have put 5 minutes for imsak. It is better that we stop eating or drinking a few minutes before the adhan of fajr as a precaution to make sure that I have fulfilled the condition of God. And this is true in all things. You know, for example, in wudu, when we have to do wudu from our elbow to our tips of our fingers, What do our Maharaja say? Start higher than your elbow. Yeah? Why? To make sure that you have fulfilled the condition of the elbow. Likewise with fasting, we are to avoid these 9 things. Make sure you give yourself a cushion in the beginning and in the end. That is why it is mustahab, as I say, to pray Maghrib and Isha before you break your fast. The last rule that I want to mention about niyya, and I think this is something that many of us go through. If somebody, this is verbatim from Ayatollah Sistani, hafizahullah. If somebody is undecided before this, if you had not made your niyya, let's say you forget to make your niyya and you wake up before Dhuhr, you can still make a niyya and it will be accepted. But if you pass Dhuhr, you should still continue with abstinence from these things, but you have to give a qadha fast on that. Okay? Now, this is the rule of Sayyid Sistani. Lastly, if somebody is undecided in his niyya, whether to break the fast or not, yeah, this may happen to a lot of us. We wake up, for example, with a cold and a cough, and we're thinking to ourselves, should I fast today or should I not fast today? Yeah? If I am in that state of limbo, yeah, where I don't know if I should fast today or not fast today, my fast is automatically broken because I do not have intention of fasting today. Yeah? Hence it is important that I keep in the back of my mind that I am fasting today, but I'm trying to gauge whether my condition allows me to fast or not. But if right from the back I say I'm not sure if I'm fasting today, we may do this with mustahab fast a lot, yeah? Where we tell our spouse, for example, tomorrow I'm a fast. And then she wakes you up in the morning and says, well, I don't know if I'm fasting yet. Yeah? We'll see how the next hour goes. If that happens to us in the month of Ramadan, our fast is broken. And, for example, the Sayyid Sistani says that if you make an intention to break your fast, and even if you do not break your fast is broken because you have changed your intention. So this is a rule I believe a lot of people are affected with, especially if they feel sick in the mornings. Do not lose your intention of fasting. But if you want to debate in your mind, debate it with an understanding that I am keeping my intention of fasting. Wa akhiru da'wan and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hasten the reappearance of our imam. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our parents and our loved ones. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who are going through difficulty, that He end their difficulty. For those who have asked us to remember them in their prayers, Ya Allah, please accept their hajat. And lastly, we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we do not leave the month of Ramadan in the same condition that we entered the month of Ramadan. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta as-sami'ul alim walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Rahimallahu man kara suratil mubarakatil fatiha tasbikuha bis salati ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allah.